Well, ladies and gentlemen, I'll just welcome you to the congregation here at Cultus Lake. It's not a church, it's a gathering place, and that's what we're doing here today, to remember one's life that's been so meaningful. And boy, when I read the eulogy that Richard, you've given me, the man was very busy and very active and travel and knowledgeable. Forever looking for something that he could get his brain around. And so we thank God for his life. We believe in prayer, and we ask God's blessing upon us. So would you join me in prayer? We thank you, dear God, for loving us. We thank you, dear God, for life. And we thank you, dear God, for John Mercer's life. We pray, dear God, as we think of him, the way in which we knew him, and the experiences and the memories, they'll help us to recognize that even the shortness of our own life. And we thank you, dear God, that you're the creator of all of us. You've given us an eternal soul. And we need to make sure that what we believe and what we practice would honor and glorify you. So, dear God, in our gathering today to celebrate John's life, may we sense your divine presence. Because Jesus said, when two or three are gathered together in his name, he is in the midst. And may we just in our own hearts reach out and feel that presence with us this day. God, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
The scriptures are always helpful. That God's word, and they say we're all human, and we all, when we stub our toe, we all say ouch. At least I do. And to know that our humanness, and we're limited. When I read the book of Psalms, for instance, I'm always amazed at God's patience. And when I see this face in the mirror every morning, I thought, wow, isn't God patient with me? Really? And how God loves me and cares for me, as he does for all. We're fearfully and wonderfully made, says Psalm 139. So today I just want to read a bit from Isaiah. Isaiah was a really remarkable prophet. And he basically wrote when he was mostly a teenager, but the world in his day was in turmoil, much like ours. Certainly has a lot of turmoil. And so he comes as the inspired by God, seek ye the Lord while he may be found, call upon him while he is near, and let the wicked forsake his way and the unrighteous his thoughts. And let them return to the Lord, and he will have mercy on him and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. And God says, my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are my ways your ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. So, God is in control. When you read the scriptures, you know, God isn't a distant deity so far away. But we learn the value in human life. God created all of us, said the psalmist. Every last one of us. Some don't believe that, but that's the choice we make. In fact, Psalm 136, there's 26 verses in it, and it all ends the same way. It says, his mercy endures forever. It never runs out. You'd have thought maybe once or twice telling us that, but to tell us that 26 times, obviously it's something we need to pay attention to, that his mercy endures forever. So the Bible gives clear references to us. Amos says, prepare to meet your God. Not a threat, just a loving reminder that all of us. And when we lose a loved one, a dear friend such as John, it really causes us to think that we too are terminal in this life. And so that's good. John loved the outdoors, and we'll see some of that later. But perhaps a loving God, God created had a bearing on his life. We're not sure if he made a commitment to the Lord, but I like to think in some ways, perhaps in people's dying days, if they're in a coma, that sometimes within their soul and what they've heard over their life, etc., that there's a reach out. But seek the Lord while he may be found. Jesus said to Nicodemus, who was the most religious man that probably lived, the religious content, the religious duties wasn't enough. And it's Jesus himself said, Nicodemus, you must be born again. And so that brings your person into a relationship. And that's to me what God wants, a relationship, and to build on that, and to grow in our stature and the knowledge of the love of God and what it means, and to share that with us. So God is speaking to all of us when we gather to reflect upon John today, reminding us of this. Was it Job said, God gave and God has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. I never met John, but I did meet David and Cynthia, and they've told me a little bit about John. And Richard, you've given me a few things here about your Uncle John. And John grew up in lovely Victoria, BC, with his mother, Edith, his dad, Herb, and sister, Patsy. Central to their family was a dog named Rex, and we've got a dog named
Blue.
How could I forget? But Rex was an Irish settler who brought many years of joy and companionship to the whole family. Their first family home was on Richmond Avenue in Victoria. I know that street well. Followed by a move to Murray Drive when John was just 5 years old. This coincided with the start of the Second World War, when John's father was shipped off to Scotland to serve in the Forestry Division of the Princess Patricia's Canadian Light Infantry. And so for a six-year-old during the Second World War, John and his mother and sister kept the home fires burning on Murray Drive while Dad contributed to the war effort overseas, and while at the same time sending his pay back to the family in order to keep them in food and shelter. All different days during those World Wars. It was about this time that John began his school years at Glenlyon School for Boys. And that's a special school, if you've ever been in Victoria, which he attended until high school age. Now, John's childhood experience in his academically focused school was a positive one that had a profound impact on him that would set the stage for him becoming an ardent learner and desire to read and research a wide variety of subjects that might draw his interest. John actually continued on as a member of the old boys club for this school, receiving regular newsletters and correspondence from the school right up to the present day. In fact, John would even correspond back with the principals and vice principals of the school for many years because he took great interest in education. Education mattered to John a great deal, and it was important to him to impart his research and understanding on the subjects to others for the betterment of those coming up through the education system. That all sounds like a sermon, doesn't it? I don't know what Christians are supposed to do. To this day, dozens of books on education line the shelves of his vast home library, with the many passages underlined in the pages in between as he thoroughly studied and pondered each concept. Education, of course, was not John's only interest, but being a very objective and strategic thinker, he had a keen interest in the events that transpired during the many wars that have taken place over the past century. We're never done with wars. We talk about wars to end all war, but war keeps on happening. There's something wrong. But with in mind, there's another assortment of books that can be found in John's library. There would include numerous books that detail the politics of war, the biographies of the maritime leaders and generals, and very detailed accounts of the military activity during these events. And so whether it was Rommel's little battle, strategies, or General MacArthur's mindset, John knew about it and would be able to give any university professor a run for the money on the subject. That gives you some idea. One interesting activity that John engaged in during the last 10 years was the ordering books online, making use of today's technology. John had no interest in computers or smartphones. Neither do I, so I'm in line with him there. But this is one case where he made the exception. John would have his nephew Richard order books online for him. And John often saw out very old books that may have been out of print. So these books, some of which had very obscure titles, would arrive from halfway around the world and often in poor condition, but John had to get them to satisfy some specific interest or topic that he was investigating. John would then tap into a chain of knowledge as he would read one book in which he could learn about the works of another author, and then follow up by ordering another book based on a citation from that first book, and so on and so on. And that's why he's got a big library. There was always that thirst for knowledge as John continuously added to his library. And speaking of libraries, John had another entire library made up of classical music. And we'll hear some of that in a little while. Mainly vinyl records, but some CDs as well. John was familiar with all the classic composers and their works, as he had hundreds of those records they acquired over many decades. Furthermore, John paid very close attention to acoustics, as one of his hobbies was experimenting with speakers and sound output in the room where he listened to his music, trying different speaker designs and configurations. Again, John would do his research, read up on sound dynamics, and then go out and buy the materials to build his speakers, or just make use of the items he had around the house. Always creative and never lacking in imagination. So during the war years, beyond transitioning into his teens, John continued to fill his days spending time with his family and dog Rex. But he also discovered a strong interest in drawing, something that would be indicative of not only his creativity, but also of his appreciation of nature, fine landscapes and beautiful settings. It would seem apparent that John received much of his inspiration to draw while spending many long summers at Shawnigan Lake with his mother. If you've never been at Shawnigan Lake, you've missed something. His mother and his sister and father when his father was not overseas. Another frequent companion during those summers was his cousin and best buddy, Brian, with whom he engaged in many childhood activities and sometimes of a mischievous nature. That's hard to imagine, isn't it? Just one example is where Brian recalls the time as a young boy when John decided to mess around with a hornet's nest. As Brian explained, John's antics ultimately resulted in both getting their backsides stung multiple times. It's unknown if this warranted a hospital visit. I figured it probably did. Once the war was over, the family was reunited and John headed off to Victoria High, a school from which he graduated in 1951, having completed grades 11 and 12. But following high school, John began working with a builder contract by the name of Bruce Cook. Helping to construct many small houses of great character, John picked up a great deal of knowledge about building and designs while working with Bruce, and often talked about the construction methods, even recently during the discussions relating to housing designs, architecture. People tended to live in much smaller dwellings in those days, as most people did not possess a great deal of wealth, so they made do with what was available. In fact, this was evident in John's current home, which was built in the early 1940s, as parts of the house were clearly constructed from a diverse array of scrap wood. As John pointed out, it was constructed out of whatever they could scrounge up. Folks from his neighbours. Is your house built the same way?
It was.
Still standing. In 1968, John decided to travel all around Europe. This venture even included renting an old VW van with a group of fellow travellers that he hooked up with, which allowed him to take in more sights. Bunking in many hostels and boarding houses as they made their way around several countries, he kept a record of his travels and his camera and a whole lot of Kodachrome slide film. All the interesting old buildings and picturesque landscapes would have appealed greatly to John's inquisitive mind. And John sent many letters and postcards back home to his mother and father, as well as his aunt and uncle, since he was very eager to share his adventures and stay in touch with the folks back home, of course. Towards the end of his trip, John's father took ill and it was time to return to Canada. Not long after John returned from Europe, he eventually found work as a bookkeeper and inventory specialist at Airco Business Products, a business that manufactured furnaces. And John became an expert on furnace design and whole furnace products assembly line, as it was also his job to help monitor production. He actually used his own personal time to do a great deal of research on the whole furnace manufacturing and airflow, and with frequently pass on his findings as well as research recommendations to his supervisors. He even went as far as to write a very long and thoughtful report, which was essentially a study of their business entitled How It Is / How It Could Be, which he sent off to the company head office executive in Toronto. It covered the entire manufacturing process at their plant, citing many areas for increased efficiency and better overall operations. So John was a very much engaged employee and believed in not only doing a good job, but also doing things the right way. He's not about to sit idly by when there was no room for improvement. This was John's nature. He always sought out a better way to do things, and that was reflected in every aspect of his life, whether it was something big or something small. Eventually, the Airco plant was closed due to corporate consolidations. And after working briefly for a couple of smaller companies, John settled into a job with Canada Post, where he eased his way into retirement, gradually reducing his hours of work. But being a very fit and lean man, John continued hiking and venturing out in his camper, and although he had cut back on the longer hikes in recent years, he still made his regular trips to the favorite camping spots, including his yearly pilgrimage to the majestic Rock Mountains. While John's father tragically passed away after suffering with a heart attack in the late 60s, John continued to have a close relationship with his mother, as he would frequently return to Victoria from Vancouver to visit her at her home on Stewart Avenue. John would have very long, in-depth conversations with his mother, who took a strong interest in John's life, following everything he did. They went for many hikes and long walks, and John would often take her camping right up to when she was in her early 90s. She must have been pretty fit too then, at which time he built a stool and railing system in order to help her climb aboard his camper. So after John's dad died, his mother decided to get a small black dog, which was actually a toy poodle, a very small dog that had been bred down in size. While his name was C'est Bon, French for it is good, John just liked to refer to him as the Black Speck. They would take this dog and the many that followed along on their outings. She was very much enjoyed the destination that John took her and was always ready for the next adventure. John would make sure she was managing okay along the trail when she joined him on the longer walks. His mother was a good conservationist and very strong-minded lady, as she often expressed very strong opinions and was not afraid to give a piece of her mind. You ever had a mother like that? That was a woman that you would likely not win an argument with. So John would often say, if you put my mother and Hitler in the same room to have a discussion, Hitler would have to walk away to himself. He would lose. Perhaps raising a family during the Great Depression and during the war years with her husband overseas endowed her with a great fortitude. John's nephew Richard can also speak of John's character, as with other family members and friends, Richard can express an appreciation for John's inquisitive and generous nature. And Richard yourself actually ended up the same school that John went to, Glen Lyon, almost 30 years after John. This may have had something to do with discussions that occurred between John and his mother and his sister Patsley. Even after Richard finished Glen Lyon, John was corresponding with the principal and vice principal, as there was still a sense of loyalty and interest from John. With respect to other memorable events, Richard recalls that when he was 15 years old, John took him on a trip of a lifetime, traveling around the Rocky Mountains for several weeks during the summer of 1978. It was a social experience going with someone like John, who was so very knowledgeable about all the trails and supernatural sights. John had a detailed map for every trail and point of interest and knew all the best campsites. They camped out in two level tents that folded down off the roof racks of John's big 1970 Mercury Marquis. This, of course, was engineered and built by John out of sheet aluminum. Aluminum poles and rivets and canvas. It was John applying his creative designs and knowledge, perhaps partially acquired during the years working at Airco Business Products. But John would also have done a great deal of independent research on design as well. In addition to the tent setup, John had also modified an ironing board with a collapsible seat level camping table with special features for beer drinkers. It was coffee drinkers too. But who else but John Mercer would have come up with something like that? Richard recalls another camping trip with John and Richard's father a couple of years earlier that took them up to Long Beach on Vancouver Island. They traveled there in John's old Mercedes, and once up there, John drove his car right on the beach with the trunk wide open as they collected beech wood for the campfire later that night. It was great to have an uncle that would do such cool things. Rich was also thankful for having an uncle who was so supportive, whether it be driving Richard to the airport on his first trip to Thailand, taking him in so many great camping trips all over BC, showing an interest in his work in school, or performing thoughtful one-off acts of kindness like buying and mailing several travel books to Richard when he was staying in England while doing the big trip through Europe in the 1980s. Lastly and mostly important, John was someone that Richard felt he could call up and discuss any issue and get very helpful and objective input. John had an amazing way of making things crystal clear, even if his response was something that you did not necessarily want to hear. Well, that'd be different. But John's niece Suzanne also recalls taking a strong interest in her experiences and activities. John had eagerly been waiting to take Suzanne, being his sister's eldest child, for her first drink at the Crowan Gate near Nanaimo on her 19th birthday. This consisted of a fun outing involving the consumption of a dangerous combination of black Russians and pink ladies. So, well, some of you drink will know what that is. But it had disastrous results, because a few hours later, for the backseat of John's car on the way home, since she was also prone to car sickness. So Suzanne felt badly about the events at the end of the day. It's often the case that with our first experience with alcohol, it doesn't always end the way we'd like it to. So enjoy the moment, pay for it later. On a more academic note, Suzanne wildly remembers, or vividly remembers, how John greatly encouraged her as she studied to become a teacher by taking an avid interest in her studies. John enthusiastically discussed his research and views on education with her, while garnishing her with numerous books on the subject. Just another example of John taking a genuine interest in the activities of others. So with respect to John's camping and pub crawling activities, he frequently took along his cousin Brian, with whom he shared a lifelong brotherly type relationship. Although separated by distance, Brian would come up from California to visit, as John liked to share all his special pub locations and ideal camping spots with them. As previously mentioned, those two shared a very close childhood together, with Brian coming over to the island in the summers, and the two of them spending many days at Shawinigan Lake together. Brian and John kept in close contact with each other through the years, and they shared their memories and experiences with each other. Whether it was the events of the previous week, a travel experience, or the latest update on what Brian's children, grandchildren, and wife Margaret were up to, they were always in close contact. In addition to Brian and Margaret's immediate family, it must also be mentioned that John shared a close relationship with his Aunt Maureen and Uncle Henry, Brian's parents, who John lived with in St. Margaret Street in Vancouver for a number of years. John spoke very highly of his aunt and uncle, and rightfully so, as they were both wonderful and very kind people. John's passing has hit Brian's family very hard, as they loved him very dearly. And while they are unable to join us today in person, due to the very difficult circumstances beyond their control, they are most definitely here with us in spirit, and we are thinking of them and wishing them well. Outside the family, John spent a great deal of time with friends and fellow hiking enthusiasts. John interacted with many people from his hiking groups over the years and would often correspond with them. Some of the more prominent hiking groups that John belonged to include the North Shore Hikers Club, the Golden Age Hiking Club, and the Island Mountain Ramblers from Vancouver Island. John also went out on many outings with his good friend Betty, which included trips to the opera, heading out to the many pubs that John frequented, and even going to the odd movie. John was always appreciative of the thoughtful birthday cards and nice Christmas greetings that he consistently received from Betty in the mail over the many years that they knew each other. John also enjoyed walks with his friend and neighbor Claude, with Claude's two little dogs along the Chilliwack River bank, as well as time spent with neighbour Ray, who lived across the road, with whom he had many good conversations during the occasional trip to the pub. Finally, John enjoyed a close friendship with his good neighbours Cynthia and David. They'll share in a few moments. Greatly appreciated that their help and support, and especially looking after and walking their beautiful dog Blue when they were away. In closing, one can confidently say that John Byron Mercer was a good-natured and very thoughtful individual. He was down to earth and lived an honest and simple life. He did not care about fancy clothes, material possessions, or what others thought of him. Everything in his life had a purpose, and if it did not, then he was not interested. John found his wealth in life experiences and the learning process of whatever obscure form that may have taken on. This was evidenced by the way in which he lived and how he took an interest in the people and events that surrounded him. He was a student of human nature and human experience, which he found endlessly fascinating. John was incredibly well read, and if you ever had the chance to get John alone for an in-depth conversation, then you were afforded the opportunity to tap into his wealth that John had discovered. So saying goodbye to John is difficult for all of us that had the honor of knowing him. But regardless, John would want us to carry on and would have left us with these important words of wisdom: when you pour the beer, don't foam it. So that ends history of your Uncle John, and thank you for sharing those things, Richard. And I'm sure many other things could be said, but I could sense some biblical connections, that the Spirit of God, using them in practical ways. Because that's really how the scriptures are aligned. There's just two points: doctrinal and practical. Doctrinal is truth stated, and practical is truth applied. Mm-hmm. And that's the learning we get, whatever our career is, but to learn the doctrines of God and His love for us, and apply it in a practical way. I think John did that in many ways of his life. So, enough from me, and over now to Cynthia and David. So, if you two want to come, if you want to speak first, I'll let you two decide that, and ring Blue.
Thank you very much for this opportunity to share in this celebration of life for your Uncle John. I don't know if I've ever heard a more beautiful history and tribute to anyone than what I just heard for your Uncle John. So thank you for that. It's a very great privilege for us to be here for someone we so dearly love. Our relationship with John stretches the last nearly two decades of his life. At first, he was an enigma to us, pleasant and friendly if you stopped to say hello to him, but also intensely private, almost hermit-like, content with his own company. So our first 5 years or so living next door, our involvement was as a neighbor, collecting his mail, when watching his house when he'd be away for weeks at a time, giving him lifts here and there, and bringing him homemade things, baked goods especially, and an odd meal. Really, it was just polite and essential conversation those first 5 years. Everything changed when he showed up. It was Blue who first made friends with John, capturing his heart the moment they laid eyes on each other. Whereas John was somewhat awkward and reserved around people, he was completely at ease with Blue, and soon they were bosom buddies. John called him Henry, after his mother's Cocker Spaniel. John would regularly come over or call us and ask, "Is Henry busy?" And I would ask Blue if he wanted to go out with John, and they did this little dialogue thing where Blue would talk to John and John would talk to Blue, and eventually the tail would wag and it was agreed. So the two of them would go off walking together, often for hours. More than once I went out searching for them when I was worried about one or both of them, only to find them sitting on the back step when I got home, enjoying each other's company and the snacks that I packed for them. Some days, John would call us and he'd ask, "Would Henry like a change of scenery?" Which he meant by, or which by he meant, "I am lonely. Can Blue come over and keep me company?" I usually obliged him, and so Blue came over and became as familiar with John's house as he was at ours, and as dear, I think, to John as he is to us. John even took him camping to Porto Cove with him. Over the many, many years and countless meals that we shared together across our kitchen table or that we brought over to his door, he transitioned in our lives from being a friend to being a good friend, and then to being more like our family than our own family really has been. We saw each other every day. We talked about everything and anything. We were his first point of call for any household issues, health problems, yard and garden support, doctor's appointments, pickups, drop-offs, any type of emergency, etc., etc. I grew to both enjoy and really appreciate John's candor, his slightly provocative and highly opinionated slant to conversations, especially around politics and education, and of course, his wonderful sense of humor. We often talked well into the night, long after David had fallen asleep in his armchair, about the state of the world and how to set things right, or about hiking and camping in the Rockies, which we were both passionate about, but for which John was like a human travel guide, having hiked every trail, and some of them many, many times. Some of those conversations centered around God. And though John never would confess adherence to God or to any faith at all, he never failed to ask me to pray for him when he went to his doctor's appointments, when he was awaiting test results, for traveling mercies, for good weather on his many and assorted trips, and of course, before his surgery. John loved beautiful things that stirred the heart and the imagination. A good book, a classical movie, an alpine meadow or a well-told story, a glorious piece of music, a hand-woven rug, or a freshly cut bouquet of flowers that I'd often arrange and leave on his table. Many times he would call and say, "Quick, go outside. Look at the sunset tonight. It's gorgeous." John loved hugs and phone calls, just to say hello, though he would never pick up the phone directly, but would instead wait until I started to leave a message before he would break in with, "I was just hiding." He loved good food, especially sausages and dessert. There is a tradition in our household that whenever I'm doing a formal meal, I make 3 desserts. Yes, John would eat all 3. And have second helpings of each in portions that would astonish us. And then he'd ask for a doggy bag to take home. It was quite a compliment. When his appetite changed very dramatically about 2 years ago, it was the beginning for us of the signs that all was not entirely well for him. Most days, John saw himself as a healthy man, despite his increasing memory problems and a series of health-related issues, some of which were very serious, that plagued him and tried his patience, in particular, again, over these last 2 years. Apart from me, who saw him daily and was much too involved in his personal care to be hoodwinkled, he acted to everyone else as if he was just fine, and he rarely complained about anything. So it is not surprising to me that it came as a bit of a shock to those living afar and his family that he was as bad off as he was. John's decision to go through with the heart surgery was based on the fact that his quality of life was so terribly compromised that it left him constantly out of breath, with even light exertion. Almost completely unable to tie his shoes, he'd call me and say, "Cynthia, I cannot get my shoes on or off. Can you come and help me?" And he couldn't pick things up off the floor. It left him so weak that lifting a kettle full of water was too much sometimes, and most importantly in his assessment, unable to go confidently where he wanted to go. He told me that if he couldn't go to the Rockies and hike anymore, then what was the point? In the very early hours on the day that I took John into the hospital for his surgery, he was very anxious. And nothing that I could say really soothed him. So I went into the house and got Blue. As usual, their eyes locked onto one another, and John said, "Aw, Henry, what a good boy." I picked up Blue so that John didn't have to bend over to stroke him. And Blue, with that wonderful sixth sense of animals, had apparently already assessed the situation. And without hesitation, he leaned over first to kiss John on his nose. That was his favorite place to lick John. And then to wrap his arms around John's neck in a full-on hug. It brought tears to both John's and my eyes. And John said to me, "I'm going to need a lot of dog therapy when I get out of the hospital." I told him we could arrange that. And I wonder, now looking back, if Blue already knew. John had originally asked Betty, his very good friend, and us not to come and visit him in the hospital, because he was told it was only going to be 5 days that he would be in there, and he was concerned about how he'd look. I didn't care how he looked, and I told him that, but he wouldn't budge. However, when we had been waiting all day long in the hospital from early morning for the surgery which was scheduled for that afternoon and which was bumped at the very last minute to the next day, I was not surprised to hear him say, "You will be here when I wake up, won't you?" And I said, "Yeah, of course I will. Yes, I'll be here when you wake up." But as fate or mercy would have it, because truthfully, I'm not sure that John had the reserve strength or the patience to endure that long, difficult, and very painful recovery from open heart surgery. And so after 6 days in cardiac intensive care and moments before I got to the hospital very early that morning of July the 4th to spend another day by his bedside, he died. They tell me it was very peaceful. He never woke up. John lived his life on his own terms. He did what he loved. He lived where he wanted. He spent time with those whose company he valued. And he listened very well. He rarely offered unwanted advice. He didn't actively take sides, preferring to remain neutral and not offend anyone. He was a good man. He was a good neighbor. He was a good friend. And he was a precious part of our family. We dearly loved him. And he is greatly missed by all three of us. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Cynthia. I think Cynthia's provided a lovely summary of our neighbor John. I would just like to add a few little words from my own experience. It's a very interesting thing how relationships develop over years. And because Cynthia was at home, worked out of our home, she had the accessibility, if you will, to John, and was able to reach John in areas that I just couldn't. I mean, John and I were at a very sort of, how would you say, a upper level sort of a relationship. We talked hiking, and he was interested in my work, and he always was able to offer me some good practical advice. But with Cynthia, it was different. He often referred to her as his angel, and he said, wait a minute, she's my angel. But in reality, it was like that. Cynthia was able to meet John on levels that, you know, that I just didn't. So the deeper things in life, and I think that was a real treasure. And I think whenever you do that with anybody, I think what happens is you develop an investment. And I think that's what that relationship was, a real investment for Cynthia. And that was evident in the way that she, toward the end, when John was preparing for surgery, and the work and effort that she did in preparing lovely quarters for him on the lower floor, so he didn't have to contend with stairs and all of that. It was very, very thoughtful, very, very kind. So that was really to her benefit. And I think John was very grateful for that, because I think, as we all know John the way we do, he had that kind of eccentric at times way, and he had that sort of reclusiveness that he just liked to do his own thing, as Cynthia mentioned so eloquently in her eulogy. But John and I had some wonderful times together ourselves. He was a voracious reader, as I am, and so we often would chat about the classics, Dickens and Forster and Conrad and some of the great authors, Masefield and so on. And we really had some wonderful times. And at times we did speak around the truth of God's word. He was never too committal on that, but nevertheless, he always was able to, he always respected, I would say, the word and Christ and all those things. He was always willing to adhere to that. He loved the news and he loved the weather. And he was, maybe Richard would testify to this, he was a bit of an armchair critic. He loved to sit and just, this is the way it is. And we used to have so much fun around in our home after dinner. John would just take the floor and get on his soapbox, and we used to have a lot of fun with that. And the weather was very important because of the amount of camping he used to do. And oftentimes before Cynthia and I would leave for an outing, I'd always say, well, we better check with the weatherman, see how things are going to be this weekend. And John would have a report like that. Friends, I think, finally, I would just like to say this about John, and that is that, you know, as Richard mentioned in that eulogy so beautifully, he was such an authority on the world wars, and we used to often talk about that. One of the things that I think John really, really enjoyed was just the creation. And geography. I remember he was so keen. I have a friend that I go camping with every year for 4 or 5 days in the mountains. John was so keen on how you got there. And we all know how many books on hiking he had. He'd bring out his books. How do you get in there? What's the road? Where do you get in? Oh, I've been up that trail. You know, he just loved geography. And he loved the creation as we know it. And I remember when he went to see Dr. Ross one of the final times, Dr. Ross told him, well, John, after this operation, in all probability, you might not be able to hike in the Rockies anymore. And his...
That was not a good day.
But his response was, that's fine, Dr. Ross, but I'll just go there and look at them. So I thought that was very point of John, you know, in closing. Anyway, I would just like to say in closing that John was a great neighbor, a good friend, always willing to help us. He was always willing to loan me tools, all that kind of thing. And we will dearly miss him, and we love him all the bits. And we ask that we know that he will rest in peace. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Angus.
You know, there's something about a man being connected to God without showing all the perhaps outward religious thing, but in his heart of hearts, there, you know, in his precious soul. We just pray that God has received his soul into heaven. Jesus says, "Where I am, there will be also." And all can come. All are welcome and come through the Lord Jesus Christ. There's no other name given among men whereby we must be saved. And that is the truth of God's word. I pray that John's preached that. We're going to see some slides now, a few slides, and we're going to hear some of that music that John loved, the Beethoven Sixth Symphony is going to be playing.
Thank you.
journey through his life there. And what a man, ever learning, a good example to all of us. Just thinking there, you know, as David said, as you're a lady, you know, as he lay there in the ICU, you know, he never regained consciousness. Of all his life's experiences, you know, that God, the Holy Spirit, was moving and through his heart and reminding him that, you know, he's only got a few more days in this earthen body type of thing. And the peace being made. I don't know if God does that, but God's miraculous ways. Jesus said, what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? You know, if you gain the whole world and lose your own soul, poor decision. So let us pray that John's life will be an inspiration for all of us. That we can all do better. We can all reach other people in some way. Yeah, not to be religious, but just to enjoy the love of God in a perfect, loving relationship that he's given us each day. And Richard, thank you for allowing me the opportunity to be here today and choosing this congregation.
Thank you so much.
This gathering place, as I like to refer to it. So let's pray together. Lord, we've had quite a journey this past hour on John Mercer's life, his knowledge, his ongoing search for knowledge and new things, and not to keep to himself, but to share with others. Surely that's the golden rule in practice, that he would help others in a very wonderful way. So dear God, in your marvelous ways and your miraculous ways, may you receive his soul to your care and keeping. And may you bless our souls and our lives as well this day, as we thank you for allowing to us John's life. Keep us faithful and look to these higher things in the world that's in turmoil, and it can be so discouraging, but help us, dear God, to be so disciplined that we look unto the Lord Jesus to guide us through each day of our life as we enjoy our spiritual journey. So bless us as we pack up from this gathering place and go our separate ways. And thank you again for John's life. And thank you for all here, including Blue, that have enjoyed. We ask all these mercies in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, who loved us and gave himself for us. Amen.
Amen. Amen.